Namaste. Blessed be. Welcome back to Akashic Song. I'm Kash Rocklin. And today I wanted to share with you my YouTube Pagan Challenge video for the ABCs of Witchcraft. C is for chalice. This is my little chalice. And I got this chalice probably about 4-5 years ago. And before that, it was bronze, but as soon as I started thinking about what my C video should be, it was kind of one of the first things that leapt off of my altar and out of my spirit was my chalice. It has a lot of meaning to me, even though I've had different chalices. I used to have a different chalice for every deity that I was honoring. For my ancestors, they had a separate item. For the goddess, had a separate item. If I was working with the divine masculine as a guide, that guide or god had a chalice. And if I was working, or I've always worked with the fae, but like if I was doing an offering, they had something separate. And then I think I mentioned in a previous video that my practice started to feel really, really cluttered and I wanted to pare things down. And it was a great realization that as long as my intention is pure and I'm making my intention known, I don't need a separate chalice for every, you know, every entity or being or support system that I have. So this is my little chalice. I love it. It's the size of, it's a little smaller than my hand. So it's pretty small, as you can see. So it works really great for travel. I've mentioned before that I do work with a solitary witch coven. And so when we get together and we set our altar, we each bring the items that we want to place for that particular if it's a Sabbath or if it's a new moon or what have you. And oftentimes I will bring my chalice because I love to do an offering at the end of any kind of ritual. Even if we're doing ritual crafting, I love to do an offering at that point and say, you know, gratitude for those who have supported my practice today. Most often I'm offering something like fruit juice or a red wine has been a lot of the offering. I feel like there's a significance there, which I'm going to go into. So the chalice to me represents one of the quintessential divine feminine aspects of the witch's altar. Not every witch has a chalice, but I haven't met one to date that doesn't have some form of having a place to offer items. The shape of it, even to me, is very indicative of the womb, which is why it is on the Wiccan altar. It's always on the feminine side, which is the left side. It represents the goddess. I love the silver because it's tied to the moon, and the size of it has lent itself really well to fae work, and feeling like when I make an offering to them, it's going in something that is very special. The shape, the size of it, the daintiness of it. I love the color. The inside of it is very kind of like reflective, but not as shiny as the outside. I don't know why I love that. I shine it. I keep it nice. I always keep it cleaned out. I do have a receptacle, like a red jar that has a top on it that I keep, that I refresh with blessed water. There's a crystal at the bottom of the glass. And if I'm doing wine at that time, same thing, it gets cleansed out and there'll be wine inside for offering.
I'm petting my little
Jasper. She's sitting in my lap being very snuggly and cute. There was a lot of dog meetings today between kittens and dogs. So the cats are a little bit tired. They had their little worlds rocked. Like, okay, it's time for you guys to get thrown into the world with dogs. It's time to meet the dogs. And they've met them before, but I let the dogs come up into the bedroom one at a time so that they could meet in a more controlled environment. And it went really well. Mr. Bugs is still a little frightened of them, but Lexi did really great. Anyway, I don't know why I'm going on that. Going down that path. Just because I hear her laying here purring, and she's very, I can tell she's very tired from all of the hanging out and meetings. Anywho, so the chalice represents the female womb, the womb of the goddess that we all come from the goddess, and from her, and we all come from the goddess, and to her we return. That is the meaning of the womb of the goddess. We all come through a womb. Unless we come through C-section, but generally we are all carried in a womb of some sort to be brought into this plane. And so the chalice represents the womb of the goddess, which is the holy yoni. And I've just gotten to a place where I'm doing a lot of yoni healing and yoni work. And it's one of those things that we don't really think about, I think, often enough, that all of the funky things that go on in our lives as female-bodied people, whether we identify as female or not, if you came into this world with a womb, whether you decide to use it or not, doesn't matter, you belong to the womb of this universe. You are a carrier of a womb in this universe, and you still are a part of the chalice carrier. Regardless of whether you choose to use it or are able to use it or want to or not, if you came into this world with a womb, you are one of the wombs of this plane. And I'm 100% in favor of people choosing their identification and how you express yourself. And gender is very important. And it's not, but it's also, it's really important in terms of identity and how we express ourselves in the world. And I'm 100% for, I can get into transgender stuff another day, but I'm 100% in favor of choosing the path that is true to who you are internally and how you work in your practice. But for all intents and purposes, when I say woman, I'm talking about everyone who came into this plane with a womb. And that's what the chalice represents. I tend to offer red wine quite a bit. I think I said that because it reminds me, as oddly as this may sound, I don't think it's odd. It reminds me of blood, of the blood when I cast my circle. For water, I say, the waters of our mother, for her blood that brings us to this plane and receives us again. So yoni work is important because all of the stuff that we experience in this world as womb carriers, gets shed every month. And if you're not a person who bleeds any longer, energetically, there's still a shedding that has to happen. You're taking an energy, and from some place in your being, you have to shed it, right? So a lot of times we shed a lot through the release of our orgasm or through our bodily fluids or what have you. But very intensely, or intently, I think, if you think about the fact that the womb is meant to carry life. So all of the junk that we absorb all day long has to get shed out of that place. And then when we are ready to bring life into it in the form of childbirth, you think about how many of us now have a hard time conceiving. I personally believe it's because there's so much junk that we take in all the time that we don't really address the health of our womb and of our yoni emotionally. And that's one of those things that I think that we don't ever really talk about, but I'm starting to find so much comfort in. About 2 years ago, I started practicing what I call the pink tent. And the pink tent is, it's my nod to the red tent, where if you don't know what the red tent is, it's a movement back to women's wisdom and women bonding together around our stories, our expression, and our bodies during blood time. I like to call it moon time, but what have you. When we are bleeding, there's so much, the ancestors say there's so much wisdom that's being released. And I used to go, I still do, but I've gone to a few sweat lodge rituals, and they ask you if you are bleeding not to go into the tent, not because there's something wrong with you or because you're not holy, but because it's the belief is that there's so much natural wisdom that's being released by that woman's body, that hot, stone, sweaty, dark room. It is like going into a womb. So it's kind of like re-wombing while you're already wombing. It's kind of like it's too much. And so that was something that I had to really think about. Like, I hadn't really processed it that way, that when I go into the sweat lodge, it's pitch black. You can't see anything. You can't feel, you can't see the face of the person who's sitting directly next to you, whose knee is lying on you. All you feel is skin to skin. It's hot. You're sweating, surrounded by other women. There are holy women who are leading us in chant and song. These stone people are brought in. And when I say stone people, meaning they're stones, but they are, they're holy stones, and they've been blessed to carry the vibration of our ancestors to help with healing. The whole point of being in a sweat lodge is for healing and for release and cleansing. And I went through a beautiful ceremony, and so much like old shit and darkness and gunk was just released from my body and my spirit, my heart. And I had just finally made that connection that, oh, why didn't this really occur to me? That I'm going into a womb where my ancestors are waiting to take from me all of the stuff I no longer need through this, through sweat and through releasing this from my pores. I'm getting an air bath from the steam. I'm getting a water bath, water cleansing from the sweat. There's the fire that is holding the stones and bringing the heat up. And then we're sitting on the earth. That's the only thing that you are sure of, is that you're sitting on the earth. And I closed my eyes and I opened my eyes and looked around me in this pitch black room with these beautiful singing female womb voices. And I could see these sparks. And they tell you the little sparks of light. Those are your ancestors talking to you if you can see them. And so that was really powerful for me to make that connection. I felt really safe to release the things that my womb was holding. It was shortly thereafter that I started to really participate and do a lot of research around the Red Tent movement. And for me, I wanted it to be about self-love. And I didn't do this with any other women, which is why it was a solitary thing, but I wanted to name it the Pink Tent so that it was more about being loving. And I will share that I'm still tenting right now. I'm still in my pink tent. I've got my pink little flowers in here in my scarf. And so I light a pink candle and I dress it and send an intention of what it is that I want to actively release from my womb, for the health of my yoni and the health of my spirit. And I'll put crystals around it, crystals that are calling to me for balance, for healing, for grounding and centering. And I'll burn incense and I let myself have some delicious, chocolate of some sort. I got some beautiful vegan dark chocolate mint, dark chocolate and mint flavored chocolate from Endangered Species, which they're really, really good if you like that brand. And I just allow myself to be gentle. If I feel like putting a hot pad on my a little microwavable bed buddy thing on my stomach and wrapping myself in a blanket and watching YouTube videos and snuggling with one of these kitties and letting myself just be chill. And making an offering to the goddess to say, I recognize the holiness of my womb. I recognize the perfection and the power that is there. And even now, when I'm, you know, uncomfortable and cramping and tired and cold and grumpy, I can give myself love and recognize that I am connected to the cycle of life on this planet by being a carrier of a womb. And so looking at this little chalice on my altar, I'm reminded every time I make an offering in this chalice, I am confirming that I am a part of a beautiful cycle, that I am a womb, and I give offerings through this womb back to the goddess in gratitude and in love and in harmony. And it's just been one of the parts of my practice that was so intuitive. I didn't do a lot of studying on how people do offerings, or I didn't do any of that. It was more so just intuitive. And it's been the part that has been longstanding. As many, 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 many things have changed, I've never cut out offerings, either because it's the new moon or the full moon, or I'm just feeling grateful, or that morning I felt a call to offer something in gratitude. And yeah, so I just wanted to share with you a very long, rambly chalice. The chalice and the part that has played in my practice, and how important it is if you have a practice around offering. Keep your chalice clean. I will sage it down. I dip my incense inside. I wipe it out constantly and keep it clean, because I do keep it up on the altar, upright, so dust gets in. Keep it clean. Keep it cleansed. And definitely when I first got it, I did do a cleansing and consecration ritual to remove any other vibrations from it. Because it was with a set of six, so I don't know where it lived before. It could have been part of a wedding. I don't know. But I definitely wanted to put my own energy on it. So I think that's all that I want to say about the chalice. Yeah, that's all I want to say. The chalice is a very, very, very integral part of my offering practice, and I am glad that I shared that with you. I'm hoping to make my D video tonight as well, so if you see the very next video and I look the same and I'm wearing the same outfit, that's what's happened. I will definitely want to get caught up since we are into March, so I should be, at this point, I believe, at E. Thank you for joining me and for sharing also your ABCs. I've been enjoying watching other people's practices. And I do fully intend to make a video on the eight limbs of yoga. I'm in the process of relocating, so there's a lot of clutter and craziness happening in my house right now. So anyway, I don't know why I went down that rambly path, but it has been a beautiful Sunday. And I'm so grateful to have this place to share with you my practice, to have community around crafting, and look forward to watching all of the rest of the videos of those of you who are sharing. So, blessed be, namaste, and have a beautiful rest of your day.